Church, how are you? Thank you, Brother Kanan. How appropriate that special to what we're going to be seeing this morning. Mana Rosita, Dios le bendiga. If I speak some Spanish every other and then, forgive me, please. I'll probably be thinking I'm preaching to the Spanish church, but thank you, Pastor Serrano. Pastor Serrano, being such a blessing to our family and to our church. I think Pastor Serrano was born in a different family. I think he's Mexican, but he was born in a Filipino family. And likewise with me, I was born in a Mexican family, but I think I have a Filipino heart. So, and many of you too. Thank you for your love for our Spanish people, and we're just so grateful. I can't say it enough, and I always tell our church that we need to be thankful to our English church, to Bible Baptist Church. If it had not been because of Bible Baptist Church, I would not have been here, and the things that God has allowed us to do. We haven't done much, but I mean, we're doing a little bit. So hopefully we'll continue to grow, and I'm just grateful for how the Lord has worked through our ministry, and I'm so glad for church. And I want to go right into the message. If we can go to the book of Acts, please, chapter 16. To some of you, yeah, let us stand, please. Let us read verses 6 through 15. So I'm going to read 6, you read 7, and we'll finish in verse number 15. Amen. I'm going to start reading, and then you guys pick up on verse 7, and we'll finish in verse 15. Now when they had gone throughout Phrygia and the region of Galatia and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia, and they passed into Mysia, came to Troas, and after he had seen the vision, immediately we endeavored to go into Macedonia, surely gathering that the Lord had called us to preach the gospel unto them. And from thence to Philippi, which is the chief city of that part of Macedonia and a colony. And we were in that city, abiding certain days. And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple of the city of Thyatira, which worshiped God, heard us, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to share your word. Thank you for Bible Baptist Church. I ask, Lord, that you would help me be a blessing this morning as I preach your word. Thank you for the specials. Thank you for the spirit of this church, Lord. I ask that you would help us do what we got to do, Lord. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. You may be seated. I know this story is it's very familiar to all of us that we've gone through the passage of Acts 16. This morning I would like to share how to keep the gospel moving forward. That is, I believe, our theme for the year, that we got to move forward. So, we noticed here that Paul, if you know the story, Paul went back on his second journey. He wanted to go back and just revisit the brethren in the same regions, a little bit up to the north, but the Lord forbid him into doing that. So that's how we come at the door to enter into Europe. So the first thing that I want to mention, and just going directly into the message, how do we keep the gospel going forward? Well, it's obvious that in order for us to move forward with the gospel, we need to preach the word of God. Amen? In verse number 13 all the way to number 18 talks about Lydia and how, to verse 15, how the Lord spoke to Lydia and how Lydia responded to the word of God. Verse 13, it says, "And on the Sabbath we went out of the city by a riverside where prayer was wont to be made. And we sat down and spake unto the woman which resorted there. And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple of the city of Thyatira, which worshiped God, heard us, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken. And when she was baptized and her household, she besought us, saying, If ye have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come into my house and abide there. And she constrained us." The Apostle Paul went to the riverside to continue preaching God's word. There was no synagogue in Philippi. Had there been one, I know Paul would have gone there, because that's what Paul was used to do. So Lydia was exposed to the gospel of the preaching of the word of God. The people that gathered by the riverside were either Jewish or had an affiliation of Judaism. But that didn't matter to Paul. Paul just wanted to preach the word of God. Amen? Lydia, the Bible says that she was a seller of purple, was greatly affected by the preaching. The Lord opened her heart in verse number 14, if you notice. In other words, the Lord prepared her heart. Luke, the writer of Acts, says that Lydia heard us. Lydia possibly heard Paul preach more than once, and the Lord had been working in her heart. Therefore, the Lord prepared her heart through the continual teaching and the preaching of the Word of God. Throughout preaching and talking to people, we notice that some people's hearts are like rocks, but others are very soft and tender. Nevertheless, the Bible teaches us that God's word never returns void. And that's a plus for us when every time that we preach the word of God. That tells us in Isaiah 55:11. Lydia, we notice in verse 14 and 15, had a change of heart. When the gospel gets exposed to people, two things happen. People either accept it or people simply rejected it. And in this case, Lydia accepted the word of God. She accepted it because the Lord had been working in her heart. She attended, the Bible says, that she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul. She gave attention to it. She took heed of what she understood. She did exactly what the preaching of the word of God convicted her to do. Notice the effect of preaching the word of God. Paul preached the word of God, and her heart was prepared so she can make a great decision. Verse number 15 says, "And when she was baptized and her household, she besought us, saying, If ye have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come into my house and abide there. And she constrained us." The Bible says that she was baptized. Amen. Isn't a good thing when people get saved and then they get baptized too? That is a good thing. We enjoy when somebody gets baptized because they're obeying the Lord in baptism. Lydia's change of heart also demonstrated her willingness to use of her resources. The Bible says that she constrained us. In other words, she forced us to stay. It's a good thing when people force us to stay and eat carne asada. Amen? Please do that quite often. Amen. I like the church fellowships because we can fellowship, we can gather, but our fellowships as Baptists is not just fellowship, it's eating. And that's a good thing. Amen. So I'm pretty sure Paul had a good feast at the house of Lydia. Amen. So she used her resources. She had a little company, and then she invested that into the work of God, of the Lord. Amen. But not only Paul preached unto Lydia, but he also preached to a damsel possessed with a spirit of divination. Let's go to verse 16, please. "And it came to pass as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a special It's by the spirit of divination, Meras, which brought her masters much gain, but soothsaying, the same follow Paul and us in Christ, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which shows unto us the way of salvation. And this did she many days, but Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out of her the same hour. So not only Paul got a chance to preach to Lydia responded well. She got saved, her family, they got baptized, and amen. Now we have a family to start a church in Philippi. But as Paul, the Bible says, as he went to prayer, a certain young lady was possessed with a spirit of divination. She was possessed. She was a fortune teller. This kind of behavior is unacceptable unto our Lord. Now, we notice here that we have another prospect that is being exposed to the preaching of the Word of God. So Paul not only preached to Lydia, but he also preached unto this spirit-possessed girl. If the gospel needs to go forward, we need to be ready to see some crazy things happen as we preach the Word of God. We see it out there. We talk to people. We knock doors. We give them a gospel tract. You don't know how people is going to respond. Some people might be possessed already. Some people might curse us. People don't open their doors. We try to do a good thing. We want to give them salvation because that's what the Lord Jesus offers. But some people just simply don't want to get saved. So we see crazy stuff go out there. Amen. And we need to be ready when we preach the Word of God. Amen. But here we have another prospect for the church of Philippi. She became a problem to Paul's preaching. Bible says that the same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show us unto us the way of salvation. I mean, you may think that she was doing something good, but she actually was giving Paul a little bit of trouble. She cried. She cried out loud. She speak and with a loud voice. Sometimes preaching God's word can get a little confrontational. I don't know if you had a chance to talk to people. Some people get offended when we give them a gospel tract. I met Mr. Jose, an older man. I was trying to talk to him about salvation. And I believe the man couldn't walk. He was just in the car. And I try to do a good thing. I try to offer salvation by the grace of God, and he didn't want to accept it. He got mad. He got offended, and he started saying stuff. He started yelling at me. So I just walked away, and he didn't want to accept the gospel tract. You're going to have, sometimes, when you preach the word of God, it's going to get a little bit confrontational. But we got to do what we got to do. We got to tell them about Christ, and I know that the Lord of God is always with us as we speak the word of God, and even though people don't want to accept the word of God, we got to keep preaching. We can't stop preaching. If we didn't preach, if we stopped preaching, then we would not have Bible Baptist Church. Amen? So we need Bible Baptist Church. We need the Spanish Church. We need churches to move forward with the gospel, and even though there is confrontation out there. Now, the good thing about it is that she was delivered by the preaching of the Word of God. In verse 18, and this did many days, but Paul, being grieved, turned and said unto the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And she came out the same hour. There's power when you preach the Word of God. There's power. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. We just got to keep preaching the Word of God. We just need to move forward. That's what Paul did. Paul just wanted to move forward with the gospel, and he did, and he continued. See, even though there was confrontation, that didn't stop Paul from preaching. He just kept going. We need to move forward. Not only Paul had a chance to preach to Lydia, not only had a chance to preach to the possessed girl, but he also had a chance to preach to the jailer and his family. Verse number 30. And brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and to all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night, and washed their stripes, and was baptized, he and all his, straightway. And when they had brought them into his house, he set meat before them, and rejoiced, believing in God with all of his house. Amen. So not only Paul had a chance to preach to Lydia, but also to the possessed girl. And now we see to the jailer and to his family. So we just need to preach the word of God. Now, if you ask me, what crowd do you wish to preach to? I say the first and the third crowd. Amen? Because I don't want to have any confrontation with anyone. Because if you notice, the first and the third, you know, gladly accepted the word of God. And they got saved and they got baptized. To Lydia and to the prison worker. Paul simply preached the word of salvation, the weight of salvation, and the whole family got saved and got baptized. See, they got baptized in the middle of the night. How many of you would like to get baptized in the middle of the night? Especially in the cold weather. When it's warm like this, it would not matter. But, I mean, in the cold weather, some people would just rather wait until the next day when Brother David Cabal turns on the water heater. Amen. I believe a couple, like a month ago or so, I got a chance to baptize Sister Maria and her daughter, and the baptism was not turned on, or the heater, and they told me, Pastor, the water is cold. I said, really? I don't tell Sister Maria and her daughter. So I baptized her. But she was excited, amen? It wasn't that cold, okay? But she got baptized. And as she stepped into the water and she noticed that it was cold, I asked her, do you want to get baptized? She said, that's okay, but she was shivering, she was trembling. But it's okay. So the prison worker and his family got baptized in the middle of the night. That's great. That's good news. And that's what we got to do. We got to preach the word of God. We got to get him saved. And we got to get him, you know, that's how the Church of Philippi started. See, churches start when you preach the word of God. They accept the word of God. They get baptized. And that's how you start a church. And that's how you start a community of Christians. Not only Paul preached the word of God, if you want to move forward with the gospel, but we also notice that besides preaching the word of God, if you want to move forward, also you're going to see persecution for preaching the word of God. If you notice in verse 19, the masters of this young lady were not very happy. Let me read it for you. And when her master saw that the hope of their gains was gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace unto the rulers and brought them to the magistrate, saying, these men being Jews do exceedingly trouble our city and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates ran after clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. See, when you preach, if you want to move forward with the preaching of the word of God, see, sometimes it won't get confrontational. But in this case, there is persecution now. Now, Paul was trying to do a good thing. See, he expelled the demon of this possessed girl, and the masters were not happy. And they falsely accuse the preachers. The Bible tells us in 1 Timothy 6:10, for the love of money is the root of all evil. Notice that Paul and his team were accused falsely and were brought to the magistrates. Apparently, the Jews had already had a reputation of causing trouble. Notice that labeling and generalizing was already an issue back then, especially against the Jews. they didn't like the Jews. Many believed that this city was anti-Semitic and their presence wasn't much welcome. Perhaps that's the reason why you don't see a synagogue in the city of Philippi. The missionaries were charged with being against the Roman culture. Although, how many of you would agree with me that preaching the word of God is a good thing? Amen. A lot of people don't think so. A lot of people are against us preaching the word of God, especially nowadays because of COVID-19. Amen? That is even amongst the Christian community. I hope that's not the case with us here at Bible Baptist Church. Amen? The truth of the matter is that with the gospel moving forward also comes opposition. If there's opposition and even anger in people's heart, it's because the preaching of the word of God might be touching areas of sin that people don't want to let go. John 3:20 says, "For every one that doeth evil hated the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved." See, they were cast into prison. They were punished, brutally punished. Verse number 22 says, "And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks." I am pretty sure the conditions of this inner prison were not the greatest conditions. I don't think there was electricity. Amen? I don't think there was a heater. Amen? I don't think they had extra clothes. See, they beat him. They stripped them naked and flogged them, and they were humiliated and thrown into prison. Imagine those wounds gone untreated for days. These cells were dark and filthy. I don't think they had bathrooms like we have nowadays. Amen? So it was a dirty place. It was very filthy. They probably didn't have extra comfy clothes to survive the cold weather. Just imagine these conditions, the odors. The night probably was very difficult for them to rest. In fact, enough reasons to volunteer to put to death first. You know, some prisoners might be volunteering. I want, kill me. I don't want to go through these conditions. Nonetheless, Paul was encouraged so much that he even wrote the book of the Epistle of Philippi. He was encouraged. Just imagine Paul trying to write the book of Philippi, Colossians, and a couple other books in these circumstances. He must have been very encouraged, regardless of the persecutions. Amen? The Bible says that in verse 25, "And at midnight Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them." See, Paul and Silas were encouraged even though there was persecution. They understood that in order for the gospel to move forward, they needed to be strong and courageous. See, if we want to move with the gospel, we need to be strong. We need to stay courageous. Psalm 50:15 says, "And call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me." Remember, there's joy in obeying God's word, even when there's trouble, even when there's persecution. We must obey the Lord. We must keep preaching. We must go out there and let others know about Christ, especially nowadays. See, time is of essence. Our Lord Jesus Christ can come anytime soon. Just ask yourself, where is the Lord going to find you? Is he going to find you doing his will? Or is he going to find you doing your own will? Psalm 119:62 says, "At midnight I will rise to give thanks unto thee because of thy righteous judgments." Verse 26, we notice that the power of God. "And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's bands were loosed." There's power when we preach the word of God, and God will certainly deliver us, even when there is persecution. God delivered Paul and Silas, And that's how they met the jailer and his family. Many of us, if not all, have never gone through this type of punishment for preaching the word of God. If you have gone through this punishment and you're still in church, praise the Lord. But many of us haven't gone through this type of punishment. In our days, many Christians have stopped preaching the word of God for much less. All they need to do is just shut their doors in front of us, and then we'll be sad and go back home and be like, I don't want to preach the word of God. Sometimes it will require a little bit of persecution in order for the preaching of the word of God to continue, to move forward. And we must do that. See, even though we say that we live in the last days, and one of the things that we need to consider is preaching the word of God, regardless of the circumstances. We just gotta let people know. That is our responsibility. People don't know that. People who are not saved, they don't know that they're going to hell. And some of them will deliberately says, I don't care. But it's still our responsibility of as Christians to let them know about Christ. Thank you, Brother Kananan, for that special. Very appropriate for preaching the word of God. And we need to do that. So in order for the gospel to keep moving forward, we need to preach the word of God. Paul did that, and that's how the church of Philippi started. But in order for that church to get started, there was persecution. They were thrown into jail, but that didn't stop them from continuing preaching the word of God. They still continue, and that's how the jailer and his family got saved and got baptized, and now we have a church in Philippi. And now you and I, we're talking about it. Amen? Who doesn't know about the church of Philippi? A lot of us already know but back then, they didn't know how much of an impact they would be unto the world. We speak about the church of Philippi. But somebody had to suffer a little bit, and he didn't back down. He just kept going forward, and the word of God just kept on preaching. And the last thing I want to mention, if you want to keep the gospel moving forward, not only by preaching the word of God, not only through persecution, but also people need to make profession of faith. Look what it says in verse 27. And the keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and to all the word in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night, and washed their feet, and washed their stripes, and was baptized, he and his and all of his straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them, and rejoiced, believing in God with all of his soul. The jailer and his family made a profession of faith. The jailer was afraid. He wanted to kill himself. But God wasn't finished with him or his family. God still wanted him to get saved. He asked, sirs, what must I do to be saved? This was Paul's opportunity to share the gospel to him and his family. And for sure, Paul did it. The main objective of preaching the word of God is for people to get saved. When you preach, you must believe that people need to get saved. The entire family heard the gospel of Christ. Everyone got saved. And everyone got baptized. Amen? That's a good turnout. And they even ministered unto Paul. The jailer and his family were baptized. I'm just glad when people get saved and when people obey on baptism. We want people to make profession of faith. Definitely. You want to go out and preach. You want to go out and let them know about Christ. But it is more encouraging when people make professions of faith. That is very encouraging to me. But it's a little bit more encouraging when they want to obey in baptism. If people don't make profession of faith and get baptized, we cannot establish a local church. And local independent Baptist churches need to carry the gospel. So, okay, let's go out and preach. But we need to establish churches, because churches are the ones that get commanded to go out and preach and replicate, and other churches will get started. Pastor Serrano was just giving a testimony how he went to Delano and he started a church over there. Now there's a church. Now they're reaching other people of Christ. Now they're giving unto missions, and they're replicating. And that's what we need to do here at Bible Baptist Church as well. We need to be praying for that intern so he can get trained and later get sent out and start a church. In our Spanish church, we also need more churches. We need to keep on preaching. We need to move forward with the gospel. We need people to get saved, make professions of faith, and we need people to get baptized, and we continue forward. When we preach the word of God, we should be expecting something to happen. One thing we must remember, the gospel needs to go forward. It will go forward, but the gates of hell should not prevail against it. Amen? Believers need to find every opportunity to preach in the word of God. When I first came to National City, the devil was trying to discourage me to not move forward with the gospel. On a couple occasions, some people told me that National City was a hard soil. So the devil was at work. One thing told me about these people that mentioned me that either they stopped preaching the word of God, or even if they did, they simply expected nothing to happen. But on the other hand, I was trusting in the Lord, so I prayed for harvest. One thing I decided the first day when I came to National City is that I was going to preach, that I was going to preach, and that I was going to preach. Amen? And thank God for that decision. Amen? We will have opposition. By the way, if there's no opposition, it's not fun. Amen? If there's no opposition, you won't grow. Amen? So we need some sort of opposition every other and then. And some of us need it more than others. Amen? So let's pray for opposition. Amen. But one thing you find out when you really preach the word of God. This is what I found out once I preached, and I continue to preach the word of God. That the seed will fall into good ground. Just remember the parable of the sower in Matthew 13:8. When the word of God was preached, it landed on different sections of the land, but it also landed in good ground. So how would you know that it will land in good ground? If you continue to preach. But if you stop preaching, you will know. And if you get discouraged at the first door that you knock, that they shut the door in front of you, or they don't want to take your gospel track, you won't know that the next door might be a good soil, a good ground. Amen? So we just need to continue to preach. It takes no magic in keeping the church and the gospel going forward. It worked with Paul when he started the church of Philippi. It worked with Christ when he started the church in Jerusalem. And you better be sure that he will continue to work in our days as well. Amen? Because we still have the word of God with us. Amen? We need to preach. We will find, we'll encounter persecution. But thank God, there's still people out there that are still ready to make professions of faith. Amen? And that's the message this morning, that we need to continue. So if you want to continue with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, we got to keep on preaching. There's no other way. Sometimes I wish there was other ways. We have technology. We could do that. But we still need to talk to people one-on-one. Amen? You can't talk to people one-on-one if you're just looking or staring at a camera. As much as we like technology, there's a better way. one-on-one preaching. Amen? Amen. We need to go out there. We need to let people know about Christ. And for sure, and there's a promise, because that's a promise from God. There's somebody out there waiting for you. Amen. Some people are waiting for me. Some people are waiting for Pastor Serrano. Some people are waiting for Sister. Some people are waiting for my wife and my children. And also some people are waiting specifically for you. Amen? This has been my experience. We go out and preach. We knock doors. We give gospel tracts. Sometimes we don't bring visitors. But we come to church. People come. And I didn't invite them. But the Lord convinced them to come. Amen? Because who's interested in them getting saved is the Lord Jesus Christ. All we got to do is the little we could do. Amen? We just need to let them know about Christ. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to preach this morning and be of an encouragement to our church, Bible Baptist Church, Lord. Thank you for Pastor Serrano. Thank you for their heart. Thank you for their work. Thank you for their contribution to the missions program, Lord. Just want to encourage our church about preaching the word of God and continuing with the gospel. You might be here this morning, but you don't know that if you're saved. I'd like for you to take the opportunity right now. Maybe we have counselors that can talk to you about salvation. If you were to die this morning, are you 100% sure that you will go to heaven? If your answer is a maybe, if your answer is a no, it is a good opportunity for you to make a decision this morning. So I want to encourage you to get saved this morning. Just give us a hand, let us know, raise your hand, and some of the counselors will come to you and speak to you about salvation. Let's continue to pray. Pastor?
What a blessing. The message is very clear. I'm going to say a word of prayer in a moment. You know, we have a duty just to take the word of God and preach the word of God. It's very simple, very effective. The persecution rises. There's people that will become a professor of faith of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they will trust the Lord. Father, Lord, thank you for the message, Lord God, we heard. And Lord, we're going to take a moment for an invitation as Sister Faith gets ready to play the piano. But in this congregation like this, Lord God, we can do more. We could be sensitive to the gospel, because the gospel is what's going to save the dying soul from going to hell. And we can carry gospel tracts. And we can be sensitive to the Spirit of God to share the gospel to our friend, a neighbor, a stranger. Lord, I was reminded this week when you brought that man before me, Lord God, never expecting him to show up as I was shooting basketball. And even in my flesh, he seems to get in the way. But I'm thankful for the Spirit of God when he spoke to me to share the gospel. May it be our prayer that this week that we would be able to present the gospel to somebody, the whole gospel plan, so they can hear it. We'll water, we'll plant, and we'll water and plant again. Really, we'll preach the word of God. And then we'll trust the increase, that you will give the increase according to your time. We see it very clearly. Thank you, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray.